Well, this is Dr. Stan here at Radio Liberty, and certainly our guest this afternoon is Dr. Dennis Cuddy, who's taught at the university level, who's certainly has been a consultant to industry, was in the Reagan Department of Education, but he's a prolific writer. He's written a number of books and a frequent guest here at Radio Liberty. You can get his articles regularly on the Internet. But, Dennis, you were going to be talking about some of the problems that people have because they really don't understand what's going on today.
Right.
Go right ahead.
Well, a couple of things that have been hot topics in the news, as well as on Radio Liberty and other places, among people who listen to this program and other programs like it, are, number one, the core curriculum is a hot topic among a lot of people, a lot of parents, a lot of concerned citizens, conservatives or otherwise. And the core curriculum, Common Core as it's called, they're very well-intentioned people, very good researchers, very knowledgeable, but for some reason they really don't know the full picture of what's going on. And that's why you have to have some background, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but I'm just going to touch on it briefly to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. And then the second thing is, there's a lot of fascination with Hitler having made it to Argentina. I was listening to a very good interview Dr. Stan had with Harry Cooper, who has a book coming out now, almost literally now. And there have been recent ones by Jerome Corsi, also Gerard Williams. Dr. Stan talked to him about a month ago, and he had a book out, and a person named Shalev over in Israel had a documentary out. And then, of course, Gerard Williams and Simon Dunstan's book was made into a documentary DVD, which is very good. It's available in the United Kingdom. It's been released all over there, but you can't get it easily in America because, for obvious reasons, they don't want us to know about it. But it's been out. I mean, it's out. You can get it, and it's been released, and all the people in the United Kingdom know about it, but the Americans don't because it's being sort of prevented from getting over here. So anyway, back to the Common Core. What you have here is a lot of very fine people, conservative leaders, people who are researchers in education, and they're digging into Common Core, and they're saying, and here's what's wrong with it, and, you know, here's what's going on, and we're resisting it, and the people who are doing this are the chief council.
Hold that thought, Dennis. We'll be back in a moment here. Well, this is Dr. Stan. Our guest is Dr. Dennis Cuddy. Dr. Cuddy is simply talking about Common Core. And basically, of course, we have a lot of conservative leaders and suddenly going on to radio and television and talking about Common Core and all the things that are wrong with it and the background of Common Core. Well, go right ahead and pick up your discourse on Common Core, and this is the educational program that is being certainly introduced into education in the United States to transform education to create a federally directed form of education where the teacher simply is no longer teaching. She is simply to expedite the programming of the minds of our children along the internationalist and globalist ideas so that when they come out of their educational system, they will no longer believe in America or in freedom or in liberty or in morality. They will simply go along with the hidden agenda of the brotherhood. Go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Okay, like I said, I'm going to do this somewhat shorthand because I think after this series I have on News with Views that I'm titling Conspiracy, and it's a conversation between a skeptic and myself, I think I'll write this up for News with Views, so I'm not going to go into all the details. But basically, I'm going to say now what's missing from all of these wonderful people, these wonderful researchers, these really good citizens and conservative leaders. They tend to look at things as they are. In other words, they look at Common Core, they analyze it, they say this is what's wrong with it, let's oppose it, and they look at what they consider who's behind it, and that leads them to the Council of Chief State School Officers and also the National Governors Association, and an organization called Achieve, and the College Board. So those are the four sort of villains, and they're supported and funded by Bill Gates and, you know, the usual moneyed suspects. And that's about what they do. I mean, that's where their knowledge of this stops. They go one step back. What they need to do, and apparently what is a great religious creed for some reason among conservatives, is they don't listen to me on this show, and they don't read my books. You know, they don't order my 200-year chronology from Radio Liberty. I don't know why they don't do this, but they don't. And so I'm going to quickly go back before that. What you have to know about each of these entities, for example, the people who develop the basics of Common Core, in other words, the standards and the curriculum and so forth, is the College Board headed by David Coleman. Now, these leaders, they know the College Board is involved in this, and they know David Coleman. David Coleman is the leader. What they don't know is that David Coleman is only about 45 years old. So David Coleman isn't your usual person who has vast experience at manipulating all of this educational system into disaster. Okay, so what's a David Coleman? I mean, you know, why him? I mean, why is a 45-year-old head of the College Board? Well, if they bothered, you know, to read my stuff, they would find out that often a Bill Clinton or a Strobe Talbot or a Richard Gardner or a Walt Rostow or a William Fulbright or a George Stephanopoulos and so forth are strategically placed. Why? What do they all have in common? They're Rhodes Scholars. Well, guess what David Coleman is? A Rhodes Scholar. Surprise, surprise. But, you know, like I said, the people today looking at this, they don't know that. They don't know about my book, Secret Records Revealed in the Globalist, about the Rhodes Scholars.
And I think just briefly, the Rhodes Scholars, certainly many of them are affiliated directly or indirectly with the secret society that Cecil Rhodes created to bring about a world government. This is not imaginary. It's very real. Professor Quigley has written about it. And suddenly there is an orchestrated effort to utilize the financial and military power of the United States and Great Britain and the Commonwealth nations to bring about this one world government. It was a secret society, and it centered around the Oxford University and graduates of Oxford who were Rhodes Scholars. Go right ahead.
Susan Rice, for example, you know, the supposedly ignorant person we have in charge of national security.
She's the national security advisor to the president. Everybody wants to point your finger at Valerie Jarrett. Oh, she's the culprit. I mean, I read a whole magazine article the other day about all these three or four or five articles on Valerie Jarrett, you know, and her Marxist or at least a very liberal background. But nobody talks about Susan Rice, who is the national security advisor who meets with President Obama every day and gives him his orders. Go ahead.
And she's also the one who they sent out on Benghazi, and it was a video, you know, five per shows that morning. Yes, that video. That's what's behind Benghazi, that fundamentalist video. Well, she's a Rhodes Scholar, too. And if you look in my book, Secret Records Revealed, I put her there. I mean, her name's there. You know, all people have to do is read the thing, but for some reason, there must be this religious creed among conservatives, don't read Cuddy's books, whatever you do. I'm getting a little frustrated. So anyway, back to the Common Core. All right, so let's look at the chief, as Council of Chief State School Officers. You say, well, you know, Chief State School Officers, yes, of course, superintendents of schools and departments of education in California and Oregon and everywhere, yeah, that's it. No, those guys are busy shuffling papers. Yeah, they're agents and they do what they're told, but they're paper shufflers. What you have to look at is who the director is. See, the director, the person who actually runs the office from, you know, Washington or wherever they're at the particular time. Sometimes they plop in Northern Virginia across the Potomac. But anyway, when I was in Washington, the federal government, there was a fellow who was a nemesis of myself and a friend of mine who lived very near me, a nice, fine conservative fellow named Mike Bruner. He's a reading expert, you know, phonics reading expert. Very good, very knowledgeable. And he traveled all over the country. He still is traveling around the country showing people how they can easily improve reading with systematic intensive phonics techniques like the Spalding method. Well, there's one guy who was there. His name was Ramsey Selden. And he was our nemesis. Man, he was with the reading establishment. No, we're not going to go to strictly phonics. No. Well, guess where he went when we finally ushered him out the door? He became a director at the Council of Chief State School Officers. So these are the guys who they, whether it's Carnegie or the power lead, you know, bowing down to Carnegie. And remember, Carnegie really isn't running things either. Carnegie, as I may have told you, David Hamburg with Carnegie was told by Jim Hunt, the governor of the state that I'm in the early 80s, what to do. And so who was telling Hunt what to do? Well, Hunt was a puppet of the House of Orange, and, you know, I've included them in my writings as well, and the Power Elite, their history of future, offered by Radio Liberty. So you can see them. You can see the House of Orange.
Now, basically, Dennis, for the listeners out there, isn't that the royal house, the royalty
Dutch.
Of Great Britain?
Okay. The Royal Dutch Shell, yeah.
Royal, okay. Royal Dutch Shell, okay, go ahead. So it's really important
years.
That they all work together.
Yep.
So they are interlocked, the
yep.
Royalty, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Royal Institute for International Affairs, the people at Oxford, they're all working together for a common goal, a one-world government, a one-world financial system, and to destroy Christianity and install a new religion. You can trace them back hundreds of years. Go ahead.
Yep. Yeah, that one, that particular one, you can trace back at least 400 years. William of Orange, the House of Orange, originally was called Orange-Nassau, like Nassau in the Bahamas. So that was originally. And their plot was to basically take over England, which they did by removing the Stuarts in the 1600s. And William married Mary, M-A-R-Y, the Protestant heir to the British throne. And so together, you know, they ruled England. They came from Holland over to England, ruling. And then, you know, they named the college, William and Mary at Williamsburg after them. And in Williamsburg is where the old Bruton Parish Church is with the secret vault underground. And the Rockefellers, just as that was about to be opened, came swooped down and bought up that property down there, supposedly to renovate it. But what I think they wanted to do is get people away from that secret vault underground. And what was in the vault? Well, supposedly the last one to see it was Thomas Jefferson, who had defended Adam Weishaupt of the Illuminati. And what was going on before then, that's the 1700s. Well, before then in the 1600s is when Sir Francis Bacon died in 1625, and his book, The New Atlantis, was about this side of the Atlantic, not the European side, was published. And his nephew was Nathaniel Bacon, who came over here to Williamsburg on the James River in Virginia, had two plantations there, and old Bruton Parish Church was built right then when he was over here. And he was the one, you know, Bacon's Rebellion, all that sort of stuff. And for the next 100 years, there was sort of a stirring the pot. And when the French Revolution came about, Citizen Genet came over and stirred the pot some more for the Illuminati and so forth and so on. We've been through all that. Okay. Now, back to that. That's the House of Orange, goes back, you know, 400 years.
But I think it's important that people understand that these people had a plan. And even suddenly here you have Francis Bacon dying in 1625. But basically he was planning on using this wonderful new nation
yep.
here on the Western Hemisphere to lead in this move towards the one world government. And what's the function of our government today? What's the function of real policy of America? Is it to bring freedom? No, of course. We got 1,000 military bases throughout the world, troops stationed in 130 nations. It's all about bringing about the world government. There's not 100 Americans who really understands why suddenly we're spending so much money in our military. 40% of all the money spent in the whole world on the military is spent by the United States to bring about this one world dictatorship. Go right ahead.
Okay, just a technical addition to what we were just saying. If you actually go to a library and get the New Atlantis, which was published in 1626, if you do that, you have to remember that it's all of the Americas. So technically speaking, Sir Francis is writing about a place in South America, but his nephew Nathaniel went here to North America, to Virginia. So it's both of the Americas.
Go right ahead, Dennis.
Okay. Well, back what I was saying about the Common Core. So that's the Chief State School Officers. Now, the National Governors Association, that was headed back some years ago by Jim Hunt. And the experiments, which I'm going to talk about when we get back to the break, were conducted in this state where I am, North Carolina, and in Michigan, where Governor Engler, both of them were members of a group called ACHIEVE, which is the agent for Common Core.
We'll pick hold up that after thought. The break. Hold the thought. We'll be right back. Go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Okay. Now, What I said just before the break was the agent for the promoter, the agent for Common Core is a group called Achieve. Now, they were originally formed during the Clinton years back in the mid-90s, and Robert Schwartz was the first president. Schwartz had been where I was before I got there. I got there in 1982 at the National Institute of Education in Washington, and he was there before I was. When President Reagan came in, we sort of ushered a number of them out. We ushered, he left there. Mark Tucker left there and so on. Now, Mark Tucker wound up going with what Carnegie was going to begin, called the Carnegie Forum on Education and the Economy around 1985, and they shortly thereafter changed the name to the National Center on Education and the Economy. But that was a Carnegie entity. And remember, the reason David Hamburg, the CEO of Carnegie in the 80s, did this was because he was approached by Jim Hunt, who had written an article in Phi Delta Kappa. He was the governor of North Carolina at the time, and he is a puppet of two things. He's a puppet over all of the House of Orange. And that comes through a fellow named Burt Bennett, who I've described a number of times in the past, so I won't go through all that. But in terms of the foundations, he was telling the Carnegie Foundation what to do. And where did Hunt get his experience? He got his experience as a Ford Foundation fellow. When he was a young person in the 60s, he was a Ford Foundation fellow, not to England, not to France, not to Switzerland, not to Russia, no, to Nepal, because the reason of Nepal and Kashmir and northern India is critical to Cecil Rhodes' plan, because that's where the Aryans were supposed to have gone. Remember, Atlantis, 595 B.C., Solon, the Greek philosopher. The word Solon in your dictionary means wise person. He was an actual Greek philosopher, and he went to the priest of the Temple of Isis. I've said this before. They told him about Atlantis, and the six civilizations were died out, were destroyed, but the one, the Aryans, like Aryan race, survived and wound up in Shambhala, which is sort of, over there, Shangri-La, Shambhala, all that sort of stuff. And that's why Hitler would send Himmler and those guys over there to look for the secret ancient knowledge, right? The secret mysteries and all that stuff.
Dennis, of course, what Dennis is talking about is that the Nazis sent a expedition over into into the east, east part of India, and
yep.
Looking for it, because they really believed the Nazi movement was firmly founded in the occult, in the
yep.
supernatural. And that is, of course, why, because we pointed out repeatedly, Adolf Hitler did not die in a bunker. He was helped to escape to South America by people who are part of this world occult movement, working in the United States government and in the Vatican and in Great Britain. And Hitler lived out his life happily there in South America.
Yep.
Why? Because they were all in this together, and World War II was as phony as the next war that's coming. An awful lot of people are going to die. They died in the Second World War, and they're going to die in the coming war. May God help us. Go ahead.
And in case you're saying, well, how could the good old U.S. of A. be involved in all that stuff? Well, you have to remember that Henry Wallace had been deliberately selected as the vice president under FDR. And remember, I've mentioned in my book, The Road to Socialism and Other Places, how he wrote a letter to FDR, you are the flaming one, flaming as in the fire, and the word Illuminati, enlightened, flaming as in the solar angel, which is Lucifer, which is Blavatsky. And
hold that thought. Hold that thought. We'll be back here in just a moment. Well, this is Dr. Stan. Our guest is Dr. Dennis Cuddy. And, of course, we're talking today about what most people really don't understand, is that certainly a lot of people working at the highest levels of our great tax-exempt foundations and in our corporate world and our banking world and in government and in education who really are certainly tied into this world occult movement. It's not imaginary. It's very real. And if you read their literature, it's very obvious that these people worship a different God, and of course they are working very hard to utilize the United States to bring about a one-world government, a one-world financial system, and to destroy Christianity, and they're doing a pretty good job of it. Go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
And in terms of FDR being the flaming one, you have to remember he sent a couple of his agents out to Manly P. Hall's place out there in Ojai, I think it was, to look at his library and all his occultic stuff and, make copies of it or do whatever they could with his stuff. So FDR was perfectly knowledgeable about all these things. And so, these are individuals who are deep into all kinds of things, So anyway, back to the Common Core, and Achieve is the agent. Now, Achieve in the middle 90s was begun, and Robert Schwartz had been at NIE, and Mark Tucker left to NIE and went with the Carnegie Forum, later National Center of Education and Economy. Now, when he did that in the mid-80s, when Carnegie formed that, what happened in the late 80s is George H.W. Bush comes in. Now, you'd think a good old conservative like good old George H.W. Bush would do something conservative, wouldn't you? Fat chance. So what does he do? He appoints who? Bill Clinton? Bill Clinton, the governor of Arkansas, to hit up the national governor's meeting in Williamsburg, as in Williamsburg, William and Mary, secret vault underground, to come up with these national standards, which would then become America 2000. In the late 80s, they developed what's called America 2000 with these national standards, right? National standards. And then, of course, George Bush tweaked it a little and called it later Goals 2000, knowing Clinton comes in and he's pushing the same that same sort of stuff, because after all, George H.W. Bush had made him the head person. And and by 1992, when Bill Clinton is elected president, I have, and a number of people have circulated what's called the Dear Hillary Letter. And the Dear Hillary Letter is, I think it's November 11th of 1992, where he says, Hillary, congratulations with Bill's election, because this will now give us, a chance to put in place our plan from cradle to grave.
No, who is writing to Hillary?
Mark Tucker.
Mark Tucker, okay, go ahead.
Mark Tucker is writing to Dear Hillary. Now, how come he's writing to Dear Hillary? Well, because Hillary's on his board. I mean, here's the governor's wife of where? Arkansas? Not New York or California, but the governor's wife of Arkansas? Why would you put her on a board? Okay, so anyway, in 1992, there's this board. The National Center on Education and Economy, which Mark Tucker's the director. Who's on there? The usual suspects. You have Mario Cuomo as chairman, Jim Hunt, my governor, is the vice chairman, David Rockefeller Jr., right? Got to have a Rockefeller, Hillary Clinton, and the list goes on this National Center's board. And so Mark Tucker's saying, hot diggity dog, we're going to get a chance to put in place our plan from cradle to grave. Now, remember that. It's not just we're going to have a little difference in reading instruction in grade 3. This is cradle to grave. Everything. Their plan, right, in education. In the meantime, Hillary, of course, is working with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. How do we know this? She has her health care task force, right? Hillary Care, they're going to call it. Well, what happened with Hillary Care is, I've mentioned this before, but I'll do it real quick. Hillary Care didn't come out of nowhere. What you have is division of duties, like Carnegie will do this, and Ford Foundation sort of emphasizes immigration, and Robert Wood Johnson emphasizes health. Well, she didn't want to let go the members, remember, of her Hillary Care task force. But a fellow named Kent Masterson Brown, an attorney, I know him, he challenged it. He's in Kentucky, and I have a video of him. And he's in Kentucky, and he's the one who challenged, I think, of the Supreme Court. U.S. Supreme Court, Hillary keeping secret her membership, and he won. He beat Hillary. And in there, the court says, no, public money, you got to divulge who the members are. It turns out 1,000 of her 2,000 members, half, 1,000 of her members were affiliated with Robert Wood Johnson. My, what a coincidence. And I'll go on a little bit. I hear the break coming.
Well, I think it's important for our listeners to understand the purpose of Common Core is to control the minds, condition the minds of our children.
Yep.
To turn them into little globalists. And basically, when our kids get out of school today, our children get out of school, most of them are not Christians. They've destroyed their faith in God. And contrary to everything you hear, certainly about how most of our people are Christian, most of our people are not Christian because they've destroyed the faith of a couple of generations of people. We are still came from a Christian nation. But the purpose of education is to destroy Christianity. Okay, go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Okay, so anyway, finish up real quickly with the Hillary Care. So 1,000 of the 2,000 members were with Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And Jim Hunt, between his governorships, tenures here, was chairman. I mean, he's always, he was Pew Charitable Trust. He's heading them up. He heads up the National Governance Commission. He's, you know, he's running everything. Sooner or later, he's got his fingers in everything. Why? Well, because the House of Orange wants him to. So anyway, Kent Masterson Brown, the attorney who challenged successfully Hillary, said on this videotape was this is basically his words. He says, there was this fellow, this governor of North Carolina, who came to our state as head of the Robert Wood Johnson Mental Health for Youth Services Program. And he, this is Ken Masterson Brown, he's a descendant of Bat Masterson, he said he bought legislation. He just bought it. He says, and what they did was, you would have, let's say, a program in the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation nonprofit, right? Although it's named for the head of Johnson & Johnson, right? But it's a nonprofit foundation, you know, great, beneficent, benevolent foundation. They're doing good things, right? Okay. And Johnson & Johnson gives money to its Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And so what happened was Jim Hunt would come and say, we'll give you $100,000 to study this program, this health program. And so he gets a willing legislator in Kentucky. He says, yeah, sounds good. Well, it just so happens that if you institute the program, one of the components of it is buying a certain pharmaceutical product, which just happened to be made by Johnson & Johnson. How convenient. Now, you can't get Johnson & Johnson for this conflict of interest because they didn't do it. It was the Robert Wood Johnson nonprofit foundation, the great beneficent, benevolent Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, which did it. But the point is, Johnson & Johnson has a ton of sales of its pharmaceutical products. And in case you think this is just a Democrat thing, it's not. In my book on mental health screening, which is also offered by Radio Liberty, I put out they did the same thing in Texas with George W. Bush when he was governor there, except in that case it was Janssen Pharmaceuticals.
Hold that thought, and we'll be back here in just a moment here. Well, this is Dr. Stan, and Dr. Cuddy is simply talking about how these people in the city will buy legislation, and they will come in and they'll give large sums of money, or for instance, certain legislators, and they have to get certain legislation passed, but it'll involve buying certain pharmaceutical products, and of course, basically, why? Because the foundation is funded by these corporations, and then, of course, the corporations give money to politicians to get the legislation passed. To buy these products, and of course, basically, the company, the pharmaceutical company, isn't bribing the politician.
Right.
It is the foundation that got the money that is bribing the foundation, and that's the way the system really works, ladies and gentlemen. And what we see is this increasing centralization of financial power in just a very small number of corporations. We have a small number of corporations that really run our government, and they do it from behind the scenes, and they have person really doesn't understand how the system works. Go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Yeah, now the foundation wouldn't use the word bribe. What they would say is, we're just offering $100,000 to look at this wonderful health program that you will, study, and if you want to, you adopt. But that's entirely up to you. But it just so happens that the health program involves buying the pharmaceuticals produced by the corporation, which gives money to the foundation. So anyway, under George H.W. Bush, it was the Janssen Pharmaceuticals, and Janssen is a sub-outlet, whatever you want to call it, of Johnson & Johnson. Janssen Pharmaceuticals is one of their sub-parts. They have several of them, but Janssen, I think it's J-A-N-S-S-E-N, Janssen Pharmaceuticals. So anyway, that's how they play the game. So back to Mark Tucker and the Dear Hillary letter and the program from cradle to grave, and she's with Robert Wood Johnson doing their sort of bidding, right? They're sort of running her. And so what happens is Mark Tucker, when he left in the mid-'80s, he actually left before I got there in 1982, then he goes with Carnegie in mid-'80s. Now, another fellow beside Ramsey Selden and Mark Tucker and Robert Schwartz, who were at NIE, which is where I came into, who was still there, Ramsey Selden was still there. Another person who was still there at NIA was a fellow named Mike Cohen. Mike Cohen. Now, toward the end of the Reagan years, when I was still there, we sort of ushered him out as well. We finally got him moved out the door. Your time is up, Mike. So anyway, so what he does is what they usually do. It's sort of, I wrote an article for the Union Leader up in Manchester called the Carnegie Department of Education. So he immediately goes to join his friends, and my immediate boss was David Mandel. He went with them as well, to join up with Mark Tucker in one of their sub-projects. The National Center on Education and Economy had a couple of sub-projects, and one of them was called the New Standards Project, the New Standards Project. And so Mike Cohen goes with them, and then Clinton, of course, is, you know, their boy. They put him into power, and, you know, he's relying on them for education. So when Clinton comes in, he wins in 92, he starts his presidency in 93, guess who he picks as his chief education advisor? Mike Cohen. So now Mike Cohen goes to the White House, and he's directing Clinton what he does on education.
Let me just comment, David, pardon me, Dennis, that what most people don't understand is why did Bill Clinton get selected as president? Why he was a Rhodes Scholar. But
right.
The average individual doesn't understand how this all fits together. A small number of elitists running the world is what it's all about. Go right ahead.
Yeah, and he also, I put in my books, like Secret Records Revealed, an actual copy of his letter and his signature on his type letter, White House Stationery, congratulating his Rhodes Scholar roommate, Strobe Talbot, on winning the Norman Cousins Global Governance Award at the World Federalist Association. And specifically in that letter, Bill Clinton says to the WFA, "Your past president, previous president, Norman Cousins, worked for world government, and he says it's a great job, a great award you've given to Strobe. He's very deserving." And then he concludes the letter, Clint does, saying, quote, "best wishes for future success." And that's to the WFA, whose sole purpose for existence is a world federal government.
The WFA is the World Federalist Association. Okay.
Right. Yeah, now,
Dennis, I don't mean to interrupt,
no,
but basically a lot of our listeners don't understand all these terms and phrases, but I want them to see how it all fits together like a jigsaw puzzle, only a deadly jigsaw puzzle that's going to lead us very soon into another terrible and horrible war where I fear that hundreds of millions are going to die. But all these wars are generated. They're all created by the ruling elite. As step after step, they hope that each time it's going to bring about the world government, and they're convinced that World War III is going to bring about a world government. But then that's why they had World War I. That's why they had World War II. Well, go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Yeah, and all this stuff, like you said, is planned way in advance. I mean, it's not just Carnegie endowments or, Carnegie has, there's the Carnegie Foundation and so forth and so on. But their Endowment for International Peace back in 1910 that Norman Dodd had his Secretary Catherine go and look at, and, you know, there's no better thing than war to get our goal of world government. It's not just that. It's not just some one foundation or endowment in New York City. This is a massive thing. So I have an actual article from 1912 in the Montreal Gazette, and in there, the Baha'u'llah, you know, is actually saying in 2 years, which is 1914, which is exactly when Sarajevo and the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand happened. He says in 2 years, the world will be set ablaze. Not in 1 year, not sometime in the future, not in 5 years, specifically 2 years, exactly 2 years, the summer of 1914, the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand by not just a couple of wackos. It was by the Narodna Odbrana, translation of the Black Hand, with Saganovich and the Princep, I think it's Princep and Saganovich, the two villains in that, basically were agents of a particular branch, they said, of Freemasonry. You know, the Freemasons, I mean, it wasn't just them. It wasn't just, I don't want to blame the First World War on the Freemasons. It's not that. But what they were tools. They were tools among other tools. And the whole thing, you know, it's the whole, it goes back hundreds of years. But anyway, this Saganovich and Princep were members of the Black Hand, the Narodna Odbrana, which carried out the assassination. So anyway, back to Mike Cohen. So now he's in the 1990s, and he's Bill Clinton's education person. And remember, he's just come out of the New Standards Project. So what they want to do is have this national curriculum, see? But they can't have a national curriculum. Why? Because there are actual federal laws. And Phyllis Schlafly's made a good presentation about this law and this law and this amended law, which says the federal government shall not blah, blah, blah. However, the federal government's very sneaky, very, very sneaky. Like when I was there in the federal government at the National Institute of Education, we didn't actually develop curriculum, but what we did was they established labs and centers around the country. There were about 16 or so, and then they increased it to about 20 all over the place. And I was monitoring the Center for Social Organization of Schools at Johns Hopkins, is what mine was. But we each had responsibility for some lab and center. And so what happened is we would give them like 49.9% of their money. So they had to come up with 50.1% of their money. So therefore the federal government could say when they developed the curriculum, hey, we didn't do it. We didn't do it. You know, we didn't give half of their money or more than half. We were less than that. So the federal government is very sneaky about this stuff. So the federal government always found ways of sneaking around the law. By, you know, not fully funding something, you know, it wasn't, you know, we weren't in control of it. You know, I mean, if we give 40, if you have a company and you have 49.9% ownership, nobody can say you did this, right? Because you don't have half. You don't have over half.
But I think it's important that people understand that our Constitution limits the power of the federal government. The federal government was never to have anything to do with education. Why? Because, of course, our founding fathers knew that if the government could have to do with education, it would eventually control it, and then it would control the minds and the reality of our children, and that's what the Common Core curriculum is all about. And the average individual has no idea of the control that exists. They wonder why our kids are so immoral. Why suddenly 40% of children today in America are born out of wedlock, actually, because you get in the black community, 72% of children are born out of wedlock. The purpose of education is to destroy the moral foundation of our country, and the federal government is gaining ever more control over every aspect of our society, and most of our young people are totally dedicated to the concept of world government. Very few of them consider them American citizens. They're citizens of this wonderful new world government that's coming. Go right ahead, Dennis.
Yeah. Now, back with the labs and centers I was talking about, one of them was called MCREL, MCREL, you know, Mid Continent Regional Education Laboratory. And it had offices in Kansas and in Colorado because it was mid continent, right? Okay. Well, one of the big shots back then was a woman named Dr. Shirley McCune. Not Shirley MacLaine, but she's similar, Shirley McCune. And she would also, you know, have an in at the White House and the Department of Education. She's sort of a curious character. Well, I have a videotape of her in Kansas back about 30 years ago, and I put some of this on my News with Views columns and in my books, which, once again, nobody reads, my Globalist. And if you look her up in my 200-year education chronology, which has a 3,000-item index, you'll see her there. And she's delivering a speech there about how they're going to transform education in the whole nation. And she's using sort of code language, right? Well, not too long after that, she comes out with a book called The Light Will Set You Free. And basically, it's an occult book, you know, the light being as in the solar angel, you know, and all this occultic, ancient, wacko stuff, right? Well, she's into that. She's into theosophy, as in Blavatsky, you know, Alice Bailey, Lucifer, so she's a big shot at this lab. And so afterwards, after she gets out of McCrell, she goes down, I think, to Arizona for a while to stir up the pot down there with a superintendent. There I have a quote from the Arizona Republic of that superintendent way back then saying that teachers are really more important than parents to their children. So then she moved after that up to Seattle. Why Seattle? Well, Seattle's a curious sort of place. They have, and I have a memo on Seattle stationery, Seattle Public School stationery, and it's from the head of the Rockefeller Project. And he's warning everybody. He says, oh, those fundamentalists, they've caught on to us. We can't use, you know, globalist education anymore. They know what we're up to with globalism. So, guys, let's change our language to multicultural. We're multicultural education. So you see their sneakiness. They're always doing something sneaky like that. So anyway, so Mike Cohen is in charge of Clinton education. Well, Bill Clinton leaves office in the year 2000. So then we get the good old conservative George W. Bush, right? I mean, now we're really going to have some conservative stuff. Fat chance. So what happens is almost immediately he appoints as his Secretary of Education Rod Paige, P-A-I-G, Rod Paige from Houston, right, Texas, Houston. Okay. So what does Rod Paige do? Is this a good conservative fellow? Oh, sure. Yeah, sure he is. He says, guess what? We're, with George W. Bush's approval, we're rejoining UNESCO. Now, if you know anything about the UN and UNESCO, it's a nasty, nasty, nasty outfit. It had something back in the 1950s called Toward World Understanding, where it was blaming parents and every problem under the sun. And we need this world government, and nationalism is bad and all that. So anyway, he appoints to Rod Paige as his Secretary of Education. And what does Rod Paige do? He says, we're rejoining UNESCO. This is wonderful. Why? Because Rod Paige says, we're going to make our kids, quote, citizens of the world. You know, just like Obama. There's no difference. No difference between Rod Paige and Obama. We're going to make citizens of the world. That's what we're going to use education for. Now, how would they do that? Well, what's the easiest way? Well, what you do is you have George W. Bush, this wonderful conservative, in 2002 join up with, who else? Teddy Kennedy. I mean, who else would a conservative join up with? So Teddy Kennedy and George W. Bush joined up to have No Child Left Behind. That was George Bush's signature piece of legislation. Well, what is No Child Left Behind?
And I think it's so vitally important. You can go back and look this up. George Bush and Teddy Kennedy working for this No Child Left Behind program. Why would such a conservative president join with the most liberal senator and, you know, pushing this program, which is internationalist, which is to control the minds of our children? Why? Because it was Teddy Kennedy's program being pushed by the Republicans. They all, most people honestly believe that George Bush was a conservative. He was not. He posed as a conservative. How else could he lead the country? But look and see what he did. He gave us the greatest increase in debt we had ever seen prior to Barack Obama. He gave us over $5 trillion in debt in 8 years. Of course, Obama's given us $7 trillion of debt in 5 years, but go right ahead.
Oh, yeah, and remember, George H.W. Bush later would give Teddy Kennedy an award down there in the Texas. And I have a postcard up here, I think, a copy of a postcard that was sent from George and Barbara Bush to the Robert Mueller School in Arlington, Texas. And you say, what's that? What's Robert Mueller School? Well, Robert Mueller School, while Secretary Generals of the UN would come and go, he would stay as the Assistant Secretary General. And I got the curriculum. I think my mother actually got it, because my mother has great files, too. And she got the curriculum. And right there at the front of the Robert Mueller curriculum, it has 40 schools around the world, but the headquarters are Arlington, Texas. It says, our curriculum is based on the underlying teachings of Alice Bailey and Joel Cool and Luciferians. And so here you have the Bushes, saying, congratulations on the Robert Mueller School's whatever number of years anniversary. You're in good old Arlington, Texas, with its good old Luciferian curriculum. This would be, you know, it'd be funny if it wasn't tragic. So anyway, so this is 2002, and George W. Bush and Teddy Kennedy get together on No Child Left Behind, which literally wipes out local control, because every state has to submit its curriculum for the approval of Rod Paige, the Secretary of Education, or you don't get any Title I funds. So naturally, the states say, okie dokie, yes, sir, we will. And so they send it up, so that's the end of local control of education. All right, so the next year, 2003, Robert Schwartz leaves Achieve, and guess who comes on board as the president? Mike Cohen, right? Because of new standards. So ever since 2003, Mike Cohen has been president of Achieve, coming from the New Standards Project, coming from directing Bill Clinton, what he's going to do. And remember, Achieve is the agent, the primary agent, the promoter of Common Core today. So you have your usual suspects. You have the National Governors Association, Jim Hunt and Engler and so forth, that Achieve had its trial runs under to develop its curriculum. You have one of the main members of it, Louis Gerstner, who is head of IBM, and he threatened, I have this article I wrote about him threatening all the states. He said, listen, if you want IBM, and there were other corporate guys, if you want us to locate or expand in your state of California or Oregon or Texas or North Carolina, you will do what we say. You will do what Achieve says, our standards, developed by Mike Cohen through these experiments in England and by Engler in the Michigan and North Carolina. And so you have this nexus of the Council of Chief State School Officers, Ramsey Seldon, so forth and so on. You have Mike Cohen with Achieve. You have the IBM and the corporate heads on board threatening the states. You better take our standards. And so, and David Coleman with the College Board, a Rhodes Scholar. All of these things come together, and that's why you have Common Core. But a lot of these leaders today, they don't know this stuff. So you need to know where it comes from.
It's all about controlling the minds of our children, controlling the minds of the next generation as we move towards the world dictatorship under the ruling elite. Dennis, you go right ahead. We've got 3 minutes to wrap up the program.
Well, with just 3 minutes, I think I'll just make a final comment about these fine people recently. And I want to reiterate, I'm not criticizing any of these people with their efforts on Hitler. I'm sure Harry Cooper is wonderful. Jerome Corsi, I know personally, he's fine. He's wonderful. Gerard Williams and Simon Dunstan, they're fine, and so forth. It's just that I think the people, the intelligence people who have fed them information, I think it's too coincidental that those people, I'm not talking about Jerome Corsi them, I'm talking about the people who fed them information, have all at the same time independently sort of done this. And why would they do this? Well, Harry Cooper is coming out, as I said now. Jerome Corsi's book was last year. I think it was originally 2012, and 2011 is when Gerard Williams and Simon Dunstan's book Gray Wolf came out. Then the next year, 2012, their documentary came out, which is available. And all of those things are after my book, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, which is copyright 2010. And then my first article on the subject was February 23rd of 2009. I find it amazing that all these intelligence people, like the email that was sent from Argentina to Jerome Corsi saying, look at the submarine number, whatever it was, in the National Archives, I find it too coincidental that all of these intelligence people started feeding all of these people information that they had long before. Now, why would they do that? Because they want people to focus on Hitler. But my point is, this is a distraction. It's a misdirection. Yes, you're interested in Hitler, but Hitler was a nothing. He was a corporal, a post guard painter. The German general staff didn't listen to him. Hitler wasn't telling Rommel what to do. Hitler was no mastermind. He was a, you know, crowd pleaser. So what the powers that be in intelligence want you to do is focus on Hitler. Look at Hitler. Hitler survived. Hitler survived. They want the whole nation world, because the last thing they want you to do is look at my stuff, which is what is really important. I'm not putting down this, their work in Hitler, but I'm saying they want to distract you. Not them, not Corsi, but the intelligence people don't want you to look at the secret Nazi plan. The secret Nazi plan is far more of a threat than looking at some postcard painter corporal who was a flunky of the power elite, Hitler.
Fascinating information, Dennis. A parting thought, and then we'll let you go.
Okay, once again, I reiterate, all those people, Jerome Corsi, Harry Cooper, are wonderful people. I'm talking about the people behind them, the intelligence people who fed it. I just think it's too coincidental. They're trying to distract people, getting all the people on the world looking at these, this about Hitler survived, Hitler survived, Hitler survived, which is a distraction from what's the real threat, the secret Nazi plan, which was developed by Bormann, Himmler, and some of the German general staff.
Well, this is Dr. Stan. Dr. Cuddy, thank you very much. We'll look forward to talking to you again next week.
Thanks for having me.
God bless. And certainly Dr. Cuddy is simply talking to us about his book, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan. And let me suggest that you get this and read this. And certainly Dr. Cuddy concurs the fact that Adolf Hitler was backed and financed by people here in the West. And certainly he was allowed to escape to South America, and we do carry the book. Certainly The Gray Wolf, we have our 4-CD set on. Did Hitler escape? Yes, Hitler escaped. And basically, of course, we've read certainly the new book by Harry Cooper, which you can have to get from him. And he's got all of these intelligence reports out there, which are readily available, that the intelligence agencies knew Hitler escaped. But of course, it's Dr. Cuddy's plan, the contention, that a lot of this information is coming out now because they don't want you to see the bigger picture. And the bigger picture is this move towards a world fascist society that is certainly being brought together. The Nazi movement was funded from its very inception from here in the United States. If you haven't read John Loftus's book, you need to get it. America's Nazi Secret and America's Nazi secret, and basically my 4-CD set of interviews with John Loftus, who had a security clearance 3 levels above top secret, and that is the war against the Jews. And my job is to get the information available. Your job is to get it, to copy it, to get it out, and to get people to understand that most of what people believe isn't true. Why is it important that Hitler escaped? Simply it reflects the fact that the media is tightly and rigidly controlled in the United States, and very few people really understand that our minds are molded, our tastes formed, our ideas suggested, largely by men we have never heard of. Statement from the opening pages of Edward Bernays' book, Propaganda, I think it was 1924, 1928, but certainly you can get that. A reference off of my newsletters. Understand, ladies and gentlemen, we're moving towards the climax in history. We're moving towards another war, and it's coming, and with it is going to be terrible consequences. Your job is to help us get the information out, to make whatever preparations you can, and certainly, but in the final analysis, the only thing that's going to get any of us through the terrible time that comes ahead, it will be our Lord Jesus Christ. And certainly, if he's not with us, why, I think that the devastation that we're going to see in America will be very much like the devastation, probably even far worse than we saw in Germany following the Second World War. Remember, about 60 to 80 million people died in World War II. Between 60 and 80 million people died in World War II. And I think that is simply only a small fraction of what's going to die in the coming war, the coming nuclear war. We're being set up for this. Understand that nobody wants the war who's rational, but we're dealing with demonic forces. And if you doubt that, certainly you need to get our materials, certainly my book, Brotherhood of Darkness, that's Brotherhood of Darkness, our 4-CD set on the Aquarian Conspiracy, our 4-CD set on the supernatural, and of course one of the writers of that, one of the people who appears in that, is William H. Kennedy, and of course, in fact, he was actually related to the Kennedy family, but he was a good conservative who died under very mysterious circumstances at age 59, and I will never believe suddenly he died of natural causes. Now, maybe I'm mistaken on that, I cannot prove, but very few, the chances that somebody 59 are going to die are pretty small, especially when you were one of the outstanding conservatives voices in America. But I've seen this. Basically, if you don't believe that they kill people, you need to get our 4-CD set, Deadly Assassins, where I actually interview 2 CIA assassins, neither one of which, of course, one I know is dead and the other, I suspect, is dead. Deadly Assassins, they're all available by calling 1-800-544-8927. This is not imaginary. You must understand we're locked in a deadly battle for the souls of men and the survival of Christian civilization. We ask you to pray for America, to pray for Radio Liberty, for our provision and protection. If you're in a position to help us, our number is 1-800-544-8927. But please pray for Radio Liberty, for our provision and our protection.